Hello and welcome to the 19th lecture in the course Optimization and Data Science. The topic of this lecture is evolution strategies for optimization. I will start with a comparison of global and local methods for optimization and deterministic and stochastic methods for optimization. So this is an overview, which is also referring to the algorithm that we already had, which were basically local and deterministic optimization methods. We had the stochastic gradient method, which is a local and stochastic optimization method. Then the second section is about evolutionary strategies, and they are connected with the name of Ingo Rechenberg in Berlin, and I will describe his ideas or his classical strategies, which always have two parameters, lambda and mu. Then there is a very sophisticated method which is available as a library and which is development coming out of the basic ideas of Rechenberg, which is this covariance matrix adaptation evolution strategy. And as last example, since we in the last lecture we had the training of neural networks, I will show very briefly an idea that was recently published to apply evolutionary strategies to the design of neural networks. So an evolutionary strategy tries to mimic the biological evolution and use this for optimization. So there are also names like evolution or evolutionary algorithms, also genetic algorithms. The differences are not very precise. Sometimes evolution strategies refer to more real valued problems, so the problems that we here mainly study in this course, where we have real variables that we want to optimize. Genetic algorithms sometimes refer to more discrete problems. And so these methods are iterative algorithms. They include stochastic parts, so they are stochastic optimization algorithms, and sometimes they are termed global methods, but this is debatable because Rechenberg, as a developer of these methods, he says that they are also local methods, and we will come to this. So the term global method is motivated by the fact that we are always in the application would like to have a global optimum or minimizer that we want to find. And we have seen in our method that we have only results where we get local minimizers. And of course, this is an important problem. How can I globalize a method? We had already globalized versions of iterative algorithms like gradient methods or Newton methods, but they are also not guaranteed that they find a global minima. Basically, there is no method that can guarantee to find a global minimizer unless the function is very simple. For example, a convex function which is everywhere, has a positive definite Hessian matrix everywhere. If we don't have this very strong assumptions, then usually we cannot say that there's a method which finds a global minimizer. Yeah, we are studying this because these evolutionary algorithms are main class of optimization algorithms, and they need only function evaluations, no gradients, and they are easily parallelizable. So this is an advantage. And they evaluate the function at a number of points, and they also use the terms of the of evolution, so they call this a population. And then these points in the parameter space are changed randomly, and the best or the fittest survive. So the best points with the lowest function values then for the cost function, they will survive. And if we have this option to use, then we have an alternative to gradient-based methods, and we can combine both ideas to hybrid methods. Yeah, so in this first section, I just want to discuss a little bit these terms global and local, and this is motivated by slides that Ingo Rechenberg also presents in his lectures in Berlin, where he has a working group on bionics, and optimization is just one part of this. So global deterministic search would mean that we search in the whole domain of our parameters, and here's always the example with the two-dimensional domain, and there is a minimizer somewhere, and a global deterministic search would mean that we check all points on the grid in this feasible set here. And of course this makes only sense if we have a bounded feasible set, which is generally the case. And then we can have some, if we want to have some accuracy, we can divide this domain in small rectangles or squares, and then we check all the values, and it's easily to be seen that this might take very long. But this would be a deterministic search, just by some given rule we look at all points on the grid in our parameter domain. And so there is no stochastics inside, and we check every point on our grid, so with a given accuracy, and then this would be a global search. But it's obvious that this will take very long. The idea of stochastic method would be not to do this line by line or row by row and column by column, but just checking randomly points in the feasible set, which would look something like this. But also use a globally random values or points in the parameter set. And the local deterministic search is what we already had. We start from some point and then we have a rule. So we have a deterministic rule following the negative gradient direction, for example. Then we go in this direction and then are doing the line search or with a fixed step size like in the stochastic gradient in the easy version. And then we again compute the gradient and change our direction. And we try, or we hope, that we come closer to the minimizer. This would be a local deterministic search if we just use, for example, the negative gradient. Then there is nothing random inside this method. The local stochastic search is starting also from some point, but then we choose randomly points in the neighborhood. So the initial value can also be chosen randomly, but this we can also do in the local deterministic search. Then the initial guess could be chosen randomly, so then there is a little bit random in this method. But here in the local stochastic search, we start in the neighborhood and put some points there and look, yeah, which is the best one, and then we proceed. This would be a local stochastic search. And it's very interesting to see, yeah, that the global search is not very promising, because it just has too much effort. And I just want to combine this. And so I'm looking now just as to the global methods and compare deterministic and stochastic. And as I said, we have a square or interval in every coordinate direction of our parameters. So we have always, for every component of our parameter, we have an interval where we look and we define an accuracy. So we say we want to have the accuracy 10 to the power of k. So we divide this interval in every coordinate direction in some subintervals or some grid. And so if we say k equal 2, we want to have here 100, so there is an accuracy of 1% in our parameter that we will find. So we split up the interval into subintervals, and this might be reasonable that we want 1% error in our minimizer, and we do this in every direction. So we need 10 to the power of k points in every dimension, and if we have n parameter, we come to this value. This is a number of function evaluations we would need if we just perform this and want to do a global search on the whole square in this case, or q cube. And yeah, we can, if we have accuracy 1% and have 7 parameters, we come to this value. If we have 40 parameters, we have a number which is not feasible. So it's easily seen, this is what's also called curse of dimensionality. This accuracy is not very high, 1%. There might be examples or applications where we want more accuracy, so k is bigger, but then we cannot do this in none of these cases here. So this is not feasible. And it's obvious that this is a very simplistic and maybe stupid idea to do it like this. But now I want to look what's happening if we do this more stochastically. One might think that this is better to just throw points there. And we do the same thing, so we have the same accuracy, and we have these number of points in total. So 10 to the power of k times n is the number of points that we have. K coming from the desired accuracy and coming from the dimension of our parameter space. If we now do a random choice, we can compute the probability to find the minimizer in the first guess. It's 1 over this number. The probability to not find the minimizer in the first guess is 1 minus this number by the rules that we had for probabilities, because these are the only two options that we have in the first guess, to find it or not to find it. Sum of the probabilities must be 1. Okay, now we do this process m times, and the probability to not find the minimizer after m guesses is this. This is a number here which is smaller than 1, so the probability to not find after m guesses, of course it goes down, but it will go down very slowly. So the probability to find the minimizer after m guesses is 1 minus the term that we had on the last slide, and we from this we can resolve this here, 1 minus p, and we can compute the logarithm, because the interesting point is now how many tries do I need, how many guesses do I need. So the m is interesting, but I can resolve this here by easy computations. So the number m of steps to find the minimizer with a given probability, let's say again 95%, can be computed like this, with just simple resolving this this equality here, and then this is a simplification that we do. This is something that people in mathematics study, that the logarithm function can be approximated like with this. So then the computation is even easier. But of course we can also use this term. So we have minus and then this logarithmic term. And again, the example 0.95, we can compute that we get, or we need, 3 times 10 to the power k times n, which is 3 times the number for the deterministic search. This is also unfeasible. The reason for this is, of course, that we do not that there's a probability that we get 2 times the same point. And of course it makes sense to, at every point we need a function evaluation in our optimization. Of course it makes sense to store the values. If I already evaluated the function at one point, then I have to store the value of the function, and I also have to store the data point that I already used, but then I have to store very many points. So I have to store then the data points. This then, of course, it's I can reduce the number, but still we are in the same order of magnitude. So a global search, there are just so many points in this high dimensional parameter space here in an n-dimensional space, that it's not feasible to find a global search if we just a global solution if we do not know anything about the function. So this is the reason why we need and we use local methods, local in the sense that they use local information on the function. And what we already had the ideas of using deterministic information. So if we can compute a derivative or a directional derivative, or if we can approximate it, then we can do something. We have some local information and we make a local descent. And the evolutional strategies, they do the same thing. And as I mentioned, Ingo Rechenberg is at the TU Berlin, and the idea is, he's not the only one who is working on this, but he's a pioneer in this, and so there are ideas of the theory of evolution, which is inheritance, mutations, recombination, and survival of the fittest. And these ideas are used in the algorithms for optimization. There are no derivatives needed, and they are parallelizable, because that we will see in the algorithm, we have always a population of many points where we evaluate the cost function, and this can be parallelized. If I have a population of 20 individuals, then I can compute the function evaluations for all these 20 points in parallel. But it's still a local method, we will see this. And this is already the algorithm in the first form, so there Rechenberg defines two parameters. And the terms or the terminology is based on population and inheritance, so there are some parents, and mu defines the number of parents. And there's offspring or children, and lambda, the second parameter, defines the number of offspring. So what we do is we choose an initial population and a mutability, and then we iterate. So we have also an iteration counter here, which is called a generation. And then in the first place, there is a variation or mutation. So we choose a parent randomly and we generate offspring. And the offspring is generated by taking this parent and randomly perturbing what they will call the genes, but the parameter values that it's mean. We take, so xi and xj just now refers not to the component of the vector, but to the vector itself. So these are all vectors here inside, in the n-dimensional case. So we take a random vector and perturb the parent with some given what's called mutability, which is the radius where we change it. And the random vector is here taken in normal distribution with mean value 0 or expectation 0, and 1 over n is what Rechenberg suggested for the variance. So this can be easily generated. This is a random vector. We perturb the parent and generate offspring. And this we do for lambda times. And here you can see it can happen that we take the same parent several times. So it's not that we take all parents, we choose randomly a parent. It might be in the extreme case that we always take the same parent. But we have then still different offspring, because for every element of the offspring we have a different random vector. And that's it, basically. And then we choose the best. We have then a population which has the size mu plus lambda, because we now have the parents and the offspring. And now we reduce this population again to the size of the parents. So the best mu survive. And this means that in the new population, P that we choose, the maximum should be, the maximum of the function values should be smaller or equal the minimum of the rest. So we just take the best. This is the mathematical formulation of the survival of the fittest. Fittest in the sense they have the best function value. And then we have a stopping criterion. And we check it, and usually the stopping criterion in the evolutional strategy is if there is no improvement in the best function value after a number of generations. And this number of generations can be very high. So it does not make sense to stop the algorithm if there is no change in one iteration. So usually The algorithms wait. Sometimes the default values for this are 100, to wait 100 generations. And there are some parameters here. Of course, the size of the population, the number of parents and offspring, the mutability are parameters that can be chosen. But this is not enough. So what we can also do to improve this is different mutabilities. So we can say we define here different mutabilities and use them here. The rest is unchanged. So then we have even more parameters. What we then can do is that we even mutate the mutabilities. So we start with initial values for this mutability, use them here, but these mutabilities that we used are already changed values of this given initial mutability. So here, what you see in the red line in the third one here is, or in the fourth one, you see that the actually used mutabilities are randomly perturbed values of this given parameters that we defined in the beginning. So here in every iteration and for every parent, we have a different mutability and they are changing randomly. And randomly in the sense, that's what Rechenberg suggested, that they just can take two values, namely alpha and 1 over alpha. But of course I can do all this also more in a general way. And the rest is the same. So now we are at the point that we perturb or mutate the parents, we change them, but also with a randomly chosen mutability. And the even more sophisticated idea is, and Rechenberg says this is necessary to obtain a really good algorithm, and the computations, if you do them, they will back this up, that we have the mutabilities and we also change them here randomly, and we do the same thing and choose the fittest here, but then we save the corresponding mutabilities. So we look what elements here or individuals we picked out of this extended population, and we remember the mutabilities. And these mutabilities we take in the next step. So also the mutabilities are inherited to the next generation. This is the idea that not only the parameter values of the best individuals should be remembered, but their mutabilities are also some kind of parameters. You can also see this like the mutabilities become additional optimization parameters. So this is a somehow self-adapting, this is the hope, a self-adapting algorithm. And this is called mutation strategy control. And this is now, it's not very difficult to implement. This is just a small change here to store these values or to remember these values. But this now is already a quite good optimization algorithm. Rechenberg has also another variant where there is not a mu plus lambda. So the mu plus lambda refers that I put here in this population both the parents and the offspring. And it can also, there's also a variant where only the offspring survives, so the parents all are not used. So we have here that only the offspring in this population, and from the offspring we choose the best. This then means that we have the parents, the number of parents is smaller than the number of the offspring, but then it's the same thing. So this is an alternative, and it's always a good question or an important question how to choose these parameters, lambda and mu. Of course, we can do this also by starting with one, But then this type would not be very useful because we just would start with one parameter, change it randomly, and then because we have only one, this randomly chosen parameter would survive, and then we can also increase our cost function. In the mu setting, it might be possible that we just take 1 plus 1, because we start with 1, we change it or mutate it randomly, then we have a second in the population, and then the best of the two survives. So this would be the minimal version of this evolutionary strategy. There are several random numbers, or several points where we have random numbers in the evolutionary strategy. We have here choosing the parent, which is then usually used a uniform distribution. They have the same probability for every parent to be taken. Here we have a normal distribution, and yeah, here is also a uniform distribution taken for both values. But this can be also replaced by using the parameter here in some interval and not just two values. I will show two examples. The first one is the optimization of the Rosenborg function. This is an example of an optimization for the Rosenborg function. So in the beginning you will see that the radius for mutation is quite big, so it's nearly this interval here, and then you can see, yeah, that the radius becoming smaller, and we know the minimum is at minus one, so here you can see we are already close to the minimizer 1, 1, but yeah, now it depends on the stopping criterion. If there is no change after a certain number of generations, the algorithm usually stops, and it might be that, yeah, if this number is very big, that there are computations which are not visible here and which don't give a very very big improvement. So we are already very close here, and so we can see even already here we are close to the minimum, and you can see here that the radius now is comparable small. But the method has no problem to find it. It's better here if you are just estimating here the number of function evaluation. If you compare this with the gradient method, it's better if you compare it with the second order method, or which uses second derivatives or approximation of second derivatives. Usually the evolutionary algorithm will lose, because a quasi-Newton method or a Newton method will be faster and better. The Grivak function has this property that we have very many local minima, and there's a global minima here inside, in the middle. Now, this example is for the Grivak function, and here in the beginning I took a very big radius for the initial guess, or for the initial population, and you can see that in this case the algorithm is successful, because, as I said, these are all local minima, the centers of this small circle-like things here, and this is the global minimizer. So you can see that in this case the algorithm finds the minimizer, but this the global minimizer, but this depends very much if one of the first points is very close, and this then will also happen in a local method, in a gradient-based method. If I start or somehow come here in the vicinity of this global minimizer, then also local gradient-based method will find this. If I don't come here, also the evolutionary algorithm will have a problem. So basically, this all depends on the first population. If my radius is big, then I have a chance to come here, but then if I I don't know at all where the minimizer is, then I am again in the problem of this global search that I described earlier, because if I don't know at all where this this minimizer here is, then the global minimizer, then it's difficult to find it, or to it's just very low probability that I will get one point in my first population which comes in this area here, and this here you can see where the point comes close to the minimizer. Then you can see there are also other points, but they were all in the end will be worse, so they will not survive. And then you see that after some iterations there are only points generated here, so now the radius is that small, and we find here again the minimizer. And again you can see that the accuracy here is big enough, and we could stop even earlier. So we could have stopped even here at this point. They were very close, depending on the accuracy we want to have. Based on Rechenberg's classical idea, there were people working in his group who then developed a more sophisticated version. And this is an algorithm which is, from many people regard this as the best algorithm for evolution strategy. I won't describe all the details, just some ideas. This can be downloaded on from websites from the developer. So here Hansen, he has on his website code for different languages. So this is nothing that we have to implement. The main differences are that the offspring is not generated by a mutation of a single individual. That's what we had. We picked the parent randomly, and then this was mutated. In this algorithm, the weighted mean of the current population is taken. So there is computed a mean, which is a weighted mean here. So, basic idea is to use the mean value of the whole population, which is then some kind of recombination of the values. And of course, the good idea is to get the best individuals. They get the highest impact here in computing this weighted mean. So one difference is that the random perturbations Z, they are not chosen to be independent for each eye. This is what we had in our algorithm, so in the version that I showed, that the every offspring here was changed individually, and the Z was just normally distributed with identically covariance matrix, so identity matrix as covariance, so they were independent. But now in this algorithm there is a given covariance matrix chosen, and this can be realized if I want to have to choose Z like this, where I prescribe a covariance matrix. Then I first generate a random vector which is normally distributed, standard normally distributed, with so independent. And for my desired matrix C, I would compute the singular value decomposition, and we will get something like this, because C is a symmetric matrix, the covariance matrix should be symmetric. So we have this, we already had the singular value decomposition, and then we set the perturbation like this. We put here the U, so this orthogonal matrix, and then we use here the square root of the sigma matrix. The sigma is a diagonal matrix, and we just take the square root of the singular values on the diagonal, and this we define as the square root of this matrix, and then times the normally standard normal distributed random vector. If we do like this, we can use our computation formula for the covariance later on. The covariance matrix C this is working if I already know what I want to have as covariance matrix, and now the question is, how can I get this covariance matrix. And this is, again, like in the quasi-Newton method, an update that is used. So we start from an initial guess for the covariance matrix, maybe the identity matrix, and then we perform similar to the BFGS method and the Broyden method, here a rank one update with, you can see here, we have the original covariance matrix from the last step with a weighting factor, and then a weighting factor, and here we again have a dyadic product of a vector. So I don't want to discuss all the details because this is really not that easy, but this is a basic idea. And here we use this sigma matrix that we have from the singular value decomposition of a given C, and then we add here the difference of our x hat, the mean value, and the x mean value from the current step. And this is the update formula that we use to obtain the C hat, which is then the next covariance matrix in the next step. So this is an iteration to update. If we have an X and an X hat, we compute the mean values, we compute this vector P hat, if we already have the P from the last step, and then we adapt the matrix C to C hat using a rank one update. So this is performed during the iteration, always also an update of the covariance matrix. So, and this is similar to the adaptation or the update in the quasi-Newton method of the Hessian. And then we can do the same thing in the next step. Again, we would do the singular value decomposition again, have the sigma and have new values for x and x hat, and do the same thing. So this is the iteration. And also the step size parameter is chosen differently. But the main idea, and this is the point I want to make, is that this is where the name comes from, there is a covariance matrix adaptation, and this is done with these two steps. So I just want you to get the main idea. There is a paper that I cite here, and they describe how this algorithm is designed in detail. So what we did is we generated our new offspring by mutation of the weighted mean. Then we took here this perturbation where we have the result of the singular value decomposition, and then here a random vector which is independent. Every component, all the components are independent, and it's normally standard normally distributed. We had a rule what happens to the covariance of matrix times a random vector. And that's exactly what we have here. We have here two matrices times a random vector. And then we can compute here the covariance matrix of this term that we add here. And then we get here the matrix A and here the matrix A transposed. And the original covariance matrix here is the identity matrix, so this disappears. We can evaluate here this transposition and get here the matrix sigma inside, and this is exactly the singular value decomposition of C. So this is the reason why we use the singular value decomposition of our covariance matrix. So this is what is done. We take the covariance matrix that we have in the current step, perform the singular value decomposition, disturb or mutate our weighted mean to generate the offspring, and then with this computation we see that the new disturbed thing has is disturbed by a random vector which has this new covariance. So in the perturbation of the weighted mean, we take into account the covariances of the current point. This is coming from this, that we take here into account the difference. Okay. At the last point, and this is also to give only to give an idea, I want to show you an idea to apply evolutionary strategy to the design of neural networks. So in the last lecture, we were talking about the training process of neural networks, and we said this was an optimization problem. But there the optimization problem was, we have a given structure, a given topology, so number of layers, nodes in the layer, this is all defined, and just the parameters of the node, these weighting factors, matrices or tensors, they were optimized. And it remains the question how to design a neural network. And so and also we had a fully connected network in the example, and this of course leads to a very high number of parameters that we optimize. And I just want to show you an idea which was published here 2 years ago by some people, how they designed a sparse network and trained an evolution, trained an artificial neural network, and they used the evolutionary idea. So they start with a fully connected network, so they defined the number of layers, they defined the number of nodes, they use some parameters, but what they basically do is every layer they replace by a sparse connected layer. So they basically, these two things here, if you look a little bit more in detail to them, what they do is they just remove edges by random, so they generate random values, and if these random values are bigger than some given parameter, then they remove one edge in the layer. So if and this means they remove randomly edges in every layer, and then they get a sparse network. And this is done randomly, so this is also some type of evolution idea here, or random idea. And then they initialize the training parameters and then perform one training, what's called epoch. It's an iteration in the optimization algorithm. So they perform the iteration, they update the parameters of the network, and then for every layer, they remove a fraction of the weights, and they remove the weights with the smallest absolute values. So in the optimization of the neural network, and if they have defined or determined the parameters, the weights parameters, if there is a very small weight on some edge, on some connection between two nodes in the network, they just omit this weight and this edge. So this is the idea, and this is also the same idea of survival of the fittest, which means if in the training process of the network one edge is not needed because the weight is very small, then this is thrown out. And the result then leads to a sparse network. So this is an example where the idea of a stochastic algorithm which uses something like survival of the fittest, which how this can be used also in the design of a sparse neural network. And of course we can even more generalize this, we can also apply an evolutionary algorithm to define the number of layers and the number of nodes, which is then a discrete problem. But the idea of starting with a randomly chosen number of layers in some bounds, for every layer a randomly chosen number of nodes, then performing this algorithm and maybe in the next iteration change randomly the number of layers and the number of nodes, this can be used in the same way with this evolutionary idea. And if then we see a given number of layers and a given number of nodes is better than others, we can stick to this choice. So the idea of designing the topology and also the number of connection in a network, to this problem we can apply the idea of stochastic algorithms and evolutionary algorithms, the best survive. And if you look in detail here, the parameters epsilon and zeta, they just use to how many edges do I want to have or do I want to remove. So this is the zeta, and the epsilon here is also given how many will be removed here, because this is the dimensions of the two successive layers. This was our parameter ML. If you go in the lecture of the last in the last lecture, you can look for the exact definition of these parameters. But this is just to give you an idea how this method of evolutionary algorithms and stochastic algorithms can be applied or combined with the classical training of neural networks. Okay, what we had, so we have evolutionary strategies as optimization methods that mimic the natural biological evolution. They build a population of parameter vectors called individuals. They change them randomly in a given mutating radius and choose the best individuals to survive in the next iteration. And these are still local methods because the mutation radius is not the whole domain. And there are different options for the choice of the population size, the number of surviving individuals, and the mutation radius. And the methods need an adaptive setting of the mutation radius to become efficient, and the CMAES is the sophisticated version, which takes into account information on the covariance, and it adapts the covariance matrix of the mutation. And there's also some rank update idea behind this. Yeah, and of course we can use parallel hardware. If we have a big population, it's very easy to compute the function value on different processors. And yeah, the methods are very good for non-smooth behavior of the cost functions, maybe because we have data uncertainties.